We're going to talk about the, in a chronological order, of the inclusion of African Americans in aviation from World War I on into the space program. But I'm going to open it up with a prayer that my father was asked to write for the United States Air Force chaplains in 1954. So if we can play that for us, please.
3, Chauncey E. Spencer. Almighty God, some of us are confused. You have said, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." Lord, I come. It's been nearly 200 years since men who wanted to be free fought for and died for American democracy. Nearly 100 years ago, our fathers were freed, a freedom that wasn't free. Lord, you saw the horrors of the Chicago, Washington, and St. Louis riots. You've heard all the abuse and have seen all of the intimidation directed against some of your people throughout the world. Lord, we know that the hate technique is used to confuse the real issue, used to blame national and international ills on innocent scapegoats and to gain followers through a common hate. Hate them for their color, their nationality, their religion, their politics, for any reason or not. Just hate them. Hate means power to those who are ruthless for selfish motives. Lord, we are so ashamed. Some of our people are guilty of joining these techniques against democracy. Smite them not, dear God. They are our brothers, and we are our brothers' keepers. Help us to nurture them into a great realm of truth, understanding, and brotherly love. Lord, I come now because they came to me. Freedom is shadowed. The democracies of the world are threatened. Trouble lurks. Equality, unity, and freedom are foremost in great minds. Yet there are those who maintain concerted efforts to keep some brothers bowed down into fear, as in the assault law decision of the Yanceyville, North Carolina court, the bombing of the home of the late Harry T. Moore family, Mims, Florida, and the current attempt to keep some children conditioned as inferior Americans by maintaining segregated school systems. Lord, what shall we do? Yes, Lord, I know there were no lynchings in the United States during 1952. There is integration with our armed forces. Americans in increasing numbers are being employed on the basis of merit and qualifications within industrial and defense programs. And too, Lord, Jesus knew their thoughts and said unto them, "Every kingdom divided against itself is brought to desolation, and every city or house divided against itself shall not stand." We'll stand, and we'll support democracy throughout the world. We always have. We only beg of thee, dear God, that you stand with us and lead all of us as American citizens of equal rights, with no exceptions. Strengthen us as stalwart Americans in unity through our churches, whatever our choice may be, and to support the United Nations in establishing there are no superior or inferior peoples anywhere in the world, and there can be and will be equality, peace, happiness, unity, and security among all mankind on this earth in the preservation of human rights, regardless of race, creed, color, or nationality. Amen.
Thank you. The first person to fight for this country's name was Eugene Jacques Boulard. Eugene Jacques Boulard came from Columbus, Georgia. He found his way to Norfolk, Virginia. His father had educated all of his sons. He had 9 sons. And he had problems down in Georgia with the Ku Klux Klan. And they firebombed his home, so the family split up. And Eugene ended up finding his way through Alabama down into Norfolk, Virginia, and stowed along a steam liner going into Ireland. And from Ireland, he found his way into Paris, where he became a lightweight boxer. In 1914, he had befriended a lot of the French, and they encouraged him to join the French army. And Eugene Boulard joined the French army in infantry. He was injured in 1916, and in 1917, they trained him as a pilot. He became the first African-American fighter pilot for America, but he had to do it by way of France. When World War I ended in 1918, he married a countess and opened up a nightclub there in Paris. And many of the literary people like Langston Hughes came to his club, washed dishes while they earned their way in their field of poetry. During and in between World War I and World War II, Eugene Bullard spoke fluent German and French. And he was in his nightclub, and some of the Germans got a little loose, and they were talking about what they're going to do to the French. This is before we start with World War II. He ended up working for the underground, the French intelligence, and they found out the Germans came looking for him, and he had to leave Paris, and he took his two daughters and came to Harlem, New York, where he operated an elevator car at the Rockefeller Center. He's buried in Flushing, New York, with the French. At the time, President Charles de Gaulle came and gave him his knighthood, and also every year somebody from France puts a wreath of flowers on his grave. He's buried in his French uniform. Eugene Bullard, the first African-American to fight for this country in the air. The second person we have on the list is Bessie Coleman. Bessie Coleman came from Atlanta, Texas. Bessie Coleman was one of 13 children. She had 1 year of college at Langston University in Oklahoma, and she ran out of money. Her mother was a washing woman. And her father was an Indian. Her father felt it was easier to be an Indian than to be a Negro, so he went back to Oklahoma to the reservations, leaving his family in Atlanta, Texas. Bessie Coleman had two brothers. They both fought in World War I. They both fought in the 8th Regiment. When they came back, they didn't come back to Texas. They went to Chicago. Bessie Coleman moved with her brothers to Chicago, where she had learned about this Eugene Bullard going over to France and getting a pilot license. She was also an admirer of Harriet Quimby, who had built her own airplane in 1911. So she knew about women being able to fly. Her brothers teased her and said, "You're not smart like the French women. You'll never learn how to fly." And Bessie didn't have a problem taking that challenge. Bessie Coleman found out through Robert Abbott, who was the founder and publisher of the Chicago Defender, that he would support her, but she would have to learn how to speak French. Bessie Coleman learned how to speak French and went to France, where she received her pilot license in 1921. While putting on an air show, she was in Jacksonville, Florida in April of 1926 when the pilot lost control of the airplane. It went into a spin. She wasn't wearing her seatbelt, and at 5,000 feet, she was thrown to her death. Bessie Coleman died in Jacksonville, Florida in April of 1926. The next person we have there is Herbert Fauntleroy Julian. He is in the dark uniform. He's from Trinidad. He also came to America and received his pilot license in 1921. He was a show-off. He went to France and got his pilot license, and he became known as the Black Eagle of Harlem. And how he did so is he flew over the East River or the Hudson River, and he let go of the plane and parachuted down into the river, making a big front page and being known, he was, and he became a politician in New York. The next person we have is William J. Powell, middle name Jennifer. William J. Powell started the Bessie Coleman Aerial Club in Los Angeles in 1928 after knowing Bessie Coleman was their idol and didn't want her legacy to go away without being recognized. So he creates the Bessie Coleman Aerial Club in Los Angeles in 1929. William Powell also fought in World War I, received the Croix de Guerre, was mustard gas, and sent back to Chicago, where he was told that if he would fight for his country, they would teach him how to fly. He came back to Chicago, and they told him, "We can't teach colors to fly, but if you come at night, we might." William Powell said, "Forget it," found a German retired pilot on East Jefferson in Los Angeles, and came to Los Angeles in 1928, where he received his pilot license. William J. Powell. And also, may I add, the Black Wings' first book that was written by William J. Powell, that they have the exhibit there at the Smithsonian Air and Space Museum. The next person we have is James H. Banning. James H. Banning came from Ames, Iowa. He received his pilot license in 1926. Before 1926, America had no pilot license. Everybody had to go to France to get an international license. He also had an instructor's rating. Powell had a pilot license, but no instructor's rating. And in order to open up a flight instruction school, he needed to have an instructor. He found out through the black press between the Pittsburgh Courier and the Chicago Defender that this James Banning had an instructor's rating. And he talked him into coming to Los Angeles, where they started the Bessie Coleman Aerial Club in 1929. James Banning died on his way to an air show in San Diego because they didn't allow blacks to fly whites anywhere, that he was more experienced and the pilot was less experienced and started showing off and lost control and crashed and killed both of them. James Banning. The next person we have up there, we have Eleanor Roosevelt in the back seat, but I'm going to talk about Charles Alfred Anderson, better known as the Chief. Chief Anderson was flying along with a partner by the name of Dr. Forsythe. And they flew over to Bahamas, and they flew over to Trinidad, and they would never get noticed by the newspapers. And they did all these fabulous flyings, but they were never noticed. Chief Anderson taught himself how to fly, ran away from home several times, as he says in his book. And I actually got to know Chief Anderson before he passed away in 1996. Chief Anderson is known as the Black Father of Aviation, Chief Anderson. The next person we have is Cornelius R. Coffey. Cornelius R. Coffey came from Arkansas. He taught himself how to work on cars and then was formally trained when he came to Chicago. He went to Detroit where he was formally trained as a master mechanic, came back to Chicago, and had a friend by the name of John C. Robinson. John C. Robinson and Coffey became very close, and they got interested in aviation. So John Robinson traded in his car on an airplane. Neither one knew how to fly it, but the dealer said, you can keep it here until you can learn how to fly it, and they did, and they had a little Jenny. Cornelius Coffey starts the Coffey School of Aviation. Out of the 450 fighter pilots that became Tuskegee Airmen, 200 were trained by him in Chicago before they went into the military. Also, all of the instructors that went to Tuskegee to train the cadets, they all had to be black. So they had to find black qualified instructors to do so. Well, Coffey had a slew of them down in Chicago, and so the majority of them came from Chicago to Tuskegee. Cornelius R. Coffey. The next person we have up here is Willa B. Brown. Willa B. Brown later marries Coffey, but before then, Willa Brown was a graduate of Northwestern, had a master's degree in business administration, and she was working at Walgreens drugstore in Chicago. And John Robinson, who was single, and Cornelius Coffey, who was single, they spotted her. And they both went out and they both tried to talk to her. So they both encouraged her to come out to the airfield on 87th Street and Harlem Avenue, which is now Oakland, Illinois, and take a look at what they're doing. And so she did, and she got bitten by the aviation bug. Willa Brown is the first African-American female officer in the Civil Air Patrol, and Coffey is the first African-American male officer in the Civil Air Patrol, or better known as the CAP. The next person we have happens to be my father. His name is Chauncey Edward Spencer. Today is his birthday. He would be 113 years old. He died at the age of 96. Chauncey Edward Spencer's claim to fame is that he, along with Dale L. White, were selected to fly from Chicago to Washington to encourage Congress to include the Negro in the Civil Pilot Training Program, which is the precursor to the Tuskegee Airmen. And on that flight, their contact was Edgar Brown. He was a lobbyist of the National Airmen's Association, and he knew all the senators and the movers and shakers in Washington. So when they landed at the airport in this Lincoln Page biplane with two instruments, an altimeter, an oil pressure gauge, and a drag tail, they were then taken on the little trolley car to the Congressional Building, where a man was standing waiting to get on the trolley car to go back out to the airport, and his name was Harry S. Truman. Nobody knew the importance of Harry S. Truman at that time. All they knew that he was introduced to them as a senator from Missouri. Harry S. Truman was very interested in the guys because they were dressed in pilot suits. So he said, Edgar, who are your two friends here? He said, well, they're trying to get into the Army Air Corps. And so Senator Truman says, well, why don't they join? And so Chauncey Spencer Sr. says, well, it seems to be for whites only, sir. He says, well, are you citizens? Yes. Do you vote? Yes. Well, where's your airplane? And so Chauncey Spencer Sr. says, it's out at the airport. So Truman says to Edgar Brown, how about if I come out and take a look at it at 3 o'clock? My father called me Pop. He said, Pop, I didn't think they were coming out. So we got out there at 3:15. Well, 3 o'clock, Truman was there and four of his administrative assistants looking at this airplane, amazed, saying, you mean to tell me you flew this thing? I'm looking at it. from Chicago to Washington? And so my father says, yes, sir, we did. Can we take you for a flight? And Truman says, no, you cannot take me for a flight, but if you got guts enough to fly this thing, I got guts enough to find out why you can't become part of the United States Army Air Corps. So this is how the door starts to open. The next person that plays a major role is Harry S. Truman. Harry S. Truman, at this time, he's just a junior senator, first year. Henry Wallace is the vice president to Roosevelt at this time. Roosevelt comes out with Executive Order 8802, Fair Employment Act, which starts the beginning of getting rid of discrimination and creating integration. But it didn't have teeth in it. And so on April the 12th of 1945, when Truman dies, by default, I'm sorry, when Roosevelt dies, by default, Truman becomes president. They were afraid of Truman. The 477 was the bombardment group of the Tuskegee Airmen were locked down in Freeman Field. They just knew they were getting ready to go in front of a firing squad because of the language Truman used, being from Missouri. He said, that's just how we talk in Missouri. They had no idea that he was the fairest president that they had faced at that time. And Truman found out about the Tuskegee Airmen that were locked down at Freeman Field, ordered them to be sent to Suffrage Field in Michigan, and started the process of the Faney Committee to look into integration in the military. So in 1946, under Executive Order 9808, starts the beginning of integration in the military and ends with the Executive Order in 1948, 9981, non-discrimination in the military and anybody that has federal contracts, in the beginning of the United States Air Force. Harry S. Truman, give him hell, Harry. The next person we have on there is Benjamin Oliver Davis. Benjamin Oliver Davis came from a great family. His father is the first African-American general in the military under the 9th and 10th Cavalry. Benjamin Oliver Davis, the first African-American to graduate from West Point in the 20th century. He was silenced for 4 years. He let one of his schoolmates, he didn't have a roommate, they would not allow any white to stay with him, so he had to stay by himself. But one of the fellows that was in his class didn't have any books, and so Benjamin Oliver Davis let him use his books, and when he gave them back to Benjamin Oliver Davis, he tore the covers off because he didn't want to be recognized borrowing books from a black man. Benjamin Oliver Davis. Benjamin Oliver Davis came out as a captain, ended up being a colonel, and becoming from there the first African-American general in the United States Air Force with 3 stars, and President Clinton then gave him his 4th star after he retired from the Air Force. Benjamin Oliver Davis. The next person we have is Noah Parrish. Noah Parrish became the colonel and the commander of the Tuskegee Airmen. If it wasn't for Noah Parrish, the Tuskegee Airmen would have never left the ground. Noah Parrish fought for them. He knew about Cornelius Coffey. He grew up in Greenville, Illinois, and he saw these colors flying around on 87th Street in Harlem Avenue. So he knew Coffey and Willa and all of them could fly. And so when they got the contract to teach through the Civil Pilot Training Program, Noah Parrish made sure that they got the same quality equipment that any of the other training facilities did. Noah Parrish's wife still comes to each one of our conventions and gives $500, and the highest award that we give for the Tuskegee Airmen is named the Noah Parrish Award. The next person we have is Grover C. Nash. Grover C. Nash was also a member of the National Airmen's Association of America, and he's the first African-American to fly U.S. mail. He flew in the Midwest. He was faster than any other of the Pony Expresses that were flying there. They gave him routes that crisscrossed him. It didn't bother him. He still was 10 minutes early. Grover C. Nash, first African-American to fly U.S. airmail. The next picture is Guion Bluford and myself. Guion Bluford, when he left in 1983 to orbit the Earth, he had all black hair. I saw him. And when he came back, he had all gray hair. So space does something to you. The next person we have who is a friend to all of us, and that's Eleanor Roosevelt. Eleanor Roosevelt's best friend was Mary McLeod Bethune. That's how she found out what was going on in the black communities. She would call Mary McLeod Bethune and say, hey, listen, I'm going to Harlem. What are you doing? Can you go with me? And she would. And so Eleanor Roosevelt was the reason why the Tuskegee Airmen were taken from ground training into combat. It's because she went to Tuskegee, not for the pilots. That was not a planned trip. She went to Tuskegee because they were working on an antidote for polio for her husband. And she went there for that, and Mary McLeod Bethune told her, while you're there, check out those color pliers. They're flying all around, but they won't let them get into action. Eleanor Roosevelt. The next picture is a picture of, at that time, the oldest African-American aviator and the youngest African-American astronaut. And that was Guion Bluford, and there's his hair, like I told you. Guion Bluford and Chauncey Spencer Sr. They traveled the world. They traveled all the bases, talking about the barriers that they came through. There's no excuse for failure. Excellence is expected. At Chauncey Spencer's death in 2002, August the 21st, he was 95. He hadn't made his 96th birthday yet. They put him on the cover of the Washington Post, flying in the face of prejudice. And that's what that is. And the end of my presentation on this portion of it is that you can find me on the internet. There's some of the places you can contact me. I'm also a volunteer at the Palm Springs Air Museum, which is a great place to be. And they've allowed me to put other exhibits in there to be more inclusive with African Americans in the museum. I have another video I want to show you. And I also have to say this before we show the video. My mother is still alive. She's 97 years old, and you'll be able to see her on the video. And I told her I'd put her out there so the people in Palm Springs. She always wanted to live in Palm Springs, by the way. I grew up in San Bernardino, California, after my father was branded a communist on the MacArthur Air as the head of personnel for the United States Air Force at Wright-Patterson. And then he was sent to Norton Air Force Base in 1956 when I was born. And we stayed here in California until 1971, where my father was the first black police commissioner for the San Bernardino Police Department and handled all of the situations that were going on with the Watts riots, where they were trying to come down through Riverside and San Bernardino. And then my father was also the president of the NAACP in San Bernardino in 1958, retired from the Air Force with 21 years on October the 6th of 1960.
Many people have heard the story of this country's first African-American combat pilots, known as the Tuskegee Airmen. But many don't know that Central Illinois played an important role in getting these men off the ground. Over 300 African-American men trained at Chanute Air Force Base in Rantoul as ground crew to support the Tuskegee Airmen. WILL AM 580's Jeff Bossert explains how these men broke down the military's color barriers while they helped win World War II.
In 1941, the U.S. was divided along racial lines. But in one small central Illinois town, nearly 300 men were attempting to break down barriers. The Chanute Air Force Base in Rantoul not only proved essential in helping pilots who played a large role in World War II, it started the integration of the military. Today, that site is known as the Octave Chanute Aerospace Museum, and recently became home to an exhibit honoring the ground support crew known as the 99th Pursuit Squadron. These men were among the first to be part of the experiment known as the Tuskegee Airmen. But nearly 70 years ago, they were more concerned with doing their job than making a statement.
We all recognized that we were being brought into the Air Force on a segregated basis. But, you know, we didn't talk about that, you know. I'm surprised as I think back of it. I mean, that didn't concern us at all.
Colonel Elmer Jones was among the first six black aviation cadets, where the other trainees and superiors were white.
We got along well. Of course, when it was dinner time, we had to go back to our barracks, which were World War I barracks. And they had been modified to accommodate us, you know, the cadets in part of that building.
In the early 40s, hundreds of other enlisted men became the core of black squadrons forming in Alabama. Prior to this time, all combat pilots had been white. But with a series of congressional moves, the military's color barrier was broken, and the U.S. Army Air Corps was forced to form an all-black combat unit. But in order for any black man to become a pilot, ground crews needed training well ahead of them.
Other bases weren't interested, didn't want black airmen on their base. And so Chanute was one of the best technical training bases that the Air Corps had. And it didn't seem to have a problem with having these guys come here, though it was segregated. And so they came to Rancho, Illinois, and did all the first group of the 99th did all their training here, that 28 weeks. They trained armorers, metal mechanics, aircraft mechanics, parachute riggers, clerks, just about any person who was on the ground, any non-pilot job, that first group was trained here at Chanute.
Instructors said the cadets caught on quickly, and their grade point average hasn't been equaled since. The group was renamed the 99th Fighter Squadron, and following 28 weeks of instruction, made its way south. In 1943, the first aviation cadets prepared for deployment to North Africa. They saw little aerial combat there, but that changed when arriving in Ramatilli, Italy, a year later. There, the 99th became part of the 332nd Fighter Group, an all-black unit consisting of four squadrons. Pilots say the ground crew workers were essential. Master Sergeant William Searcy was another among the original cadets trained at Chanute.
And the pilots always said that we should fly with them. Actually, we did fly with them during their training. And one or two pilots said they wouldn't go up unless we go up with them. They said they want to be sure that the plane operates all right.
The new display at the museum in Rantoul was largely the vision of Colonel Bill Thompson, another among the first six black aviation cadets.
Well, Colonel Thompson, he realized that the Chanute aspect of the Tuskegee Airmen story wasn't given the attention that he felt it deserved. And Colonel Bill was someone who was adamant that when we tell the story, we get it right. He didn't want it romanticized. He wanted the facts, so everyone knew the real story about where the Tuskegee Airmen started. It was here at Chanute.
Thompson died in 2006, unable to see his dream come to fruition. But his photos and financial donations helped tell part of a much larger story on the military's integration. In the first part of the 20th century, segregation and Jim Crow laws not only kept blacks from entering public places like restaurants, but restricted the types of jobs they could hold in the armed forces. But by 1939, the threat of war looming helped the prospects for African Americans to not only hold positions in the military, but become pilots. Many persevered to see the Tuskegee Airmen become a reality, including the NAACP and First Lady Eleanor Roosevelt. But the late Chauncey Spencer was one of its pioneers. As a youth growing up in Virginia, when he inquired about taking flying lessons, Spencer was told, "We don't teach colored to fly." But he later got his flight training in Chicago. The National Negro Airmen's Association of America was founded for that purpose. Joined by fellow pilot Dale White, they rented a single-engine biplane and flew to Washington to garner support. There, they had a chance meeting with a senator from Missouri named Harry Truman.
Well, we didn't know that at that time, we didn't know his name was Harry Truman. See, he's a senator from Missouri. And he said, "Is that the plane you all flew from Chicago?" And I said, "Yes, sir, that's it." I said, "Would you like to take a flight?" He said, "No, but if you got guts enough to fly that thing from there, from Chicago to here, I got guts to see that you do get into the Air Corps." And he did.
In 1941, the government issued an executive order providing for civil rights and pilot training for African Americans. And Spencer continued his efforts as an executive. Too old to fly by then, he saw to it that his dreams became reality for others. Spencer died in 2002. His wife Anne was among those who came to Rantoul last year upon the exhibit's opening.
I don't think he did it for publicity or credit. I don't think he did it for any of those things. He did it because he felt that it was something that should be done, and that's what he spent his life doing. Chauncey did not believe in black and white, and he spent years trying to eliminate the fact that a lot of people judged you by the color of your skin.
The Chanute Air Museum earned Illinois Association of Museums 2006 Superior Achievement Award, and recently the Tuskegee Airmen were awarded the Congressional Gold Medal, the highest civilian award bestowed by Congress. The battles on the home front for people like Chauncey Spencer and Bill Thompson are not only what allowed the Tuskegee Airmen to be a success, but allowed their legacy to be preserved today.
Thank you. I'd like to take any questions if we have any. I didn't do that good of a job. I know there has to be some questions. Well, let me share with you what I do here. So I'm an educator. I'm retired. I was in law enforcement. And I have a home in Detroit, and I have a home here in Palm Desert. And so I'm trying to spread the word of inclusion of curriculums. So this is not a special place. This should just be one of the field trips that the kids come to. But the classes should be in the schools. So I decided to create a nonprofit in 2004 in Michigan. And what I did is I went to the schools and I went through their committees, and it's a lot of red tape and a lot of this and a lot of that. And so I said, well, you know, by the time I get the first graders to the 12th grade, they'll still be deciding whether they're going to take my curriculum or not. So I'll make my own curriculum and take it around. So I did. So I traveled around. I was the creator of the national STEM programs for the Tuskegee Airmen's organization. It had been in existence for 42 years, and in 2014, I took it to Hampton University, which happened to be one of the main places where the Civil Pilot Training Program went on. The majority of those trainers that came, that went down to Tuskegee, came from Chicago to Hampton and on. So in 2014 and 2015, I brought 30 kids from 30 different states and two different countries, got supported by Southwest Airlines, and our foundation through the Tuskegee Airmen, Inc., we paid $50,000 to school these kids for 1 week in a residence camp. So the first year, 2014, I brought the kids there, and we did ground school. We went to Langley. We went to the Space Center. We went where they made the Black Hawks. We went through those places. In 2015, they were edging me on, when are we going to get in the air? When are we going to get in the air? Well, Virginia's not like California, so it has to be seasonal. So I had a friend in Compton at Tomorrow's Aeronautical Museum, and so I talked with him, and he said, we'd love to have it here. And so I said, well, let me see if I can get the board to approve it. So 2015, I continued at Hampton University. And then in 2016, in 2017, I brought it to Cal State Dominguez Hills in Carson. And I housed them there at the campus, 30 kids, 30 different states, two different countries. And they got 3 hours of flight time. And some of the advanced kids, including the girls who happen to be the smartest, just happen to be like that, they also got helicopter training. They flew in the R-44s. So they did that. Each one of the kids got behind the left seat. They got 3 hours of flight time. We did this all in 1 week. They also learned the history of how they got where they are, because most of them were kids of color, not that we were targeting to that, but that's what happened. And to let them know that this is something that you can take for granted now, but at one time, people like you couldn't take it for granted. And so education is my key to how and what makes us equal. If we don't have the same opportunities, then we don't have the same outcome. So the Tuskegee Airmen are a perfect example of that. They had the opportunity, they had to just seize the opportunity to do so. Because most of the Tuskegee Airmen had PhDs, master's degrees. They weren't your average Joe. And so when they came to challenges, they knew how to stay together socially. Because that was the only threat they had. The intelligence wasn't their threat. But if you put three people in a cave and they're in tight quarters, no matter who they are, after a while, it becomes a problem. Well, the Tuskegee Airmen were packed in there like that. For all this time, they were trained three times over. They were trained for 9 months. They were experts in the friendly skies of Alabama. But they hadn't been trained in combat in Ramatelli, Italy, and North Africa, and in Berlin. So there's good people, no matter what color they are. There's good people. And that proved to be so. Because if there wasn't the Harry Trumans, and if there wasn't the Eleanor Roosevelts, and there wasn't the Everett Dirksons, and these are Republicans and Democrats, then we wouldn't have the great country that we have. Yes, we have differences. That's what makes it what we are. But at the end of the day, we know that we are all one people. We're all one flag, one country, one people. So I'm not an African American. I'm Chauncey Spencer. I'm a human being, and I'm an American. And that's what I teach my kids, that's what you have to be, because the only thing that separates you from somebody else in this country is your citizenship. And your citizenship gives you the rights to have the same rights as anybody else in this country. And so it's not about race, it's not about gender, it's about citizenship. And it's about me making sure that the young people that I touch to understand that the Constitution is a contract between the people and the government, and to understand that contract, and to make them fulfill that contract. Because one thing that smart people won't tell people that are not as smart, they won't correct them. They'll keep them there so they can stay on top. Well, that's how any kind of business works. So the mindset in my set is business, because that's where my background is. But for the kids, it's being able to network with each other, because they all have great ideas. And together, they can be a moving force in this country. So I think the third grade has been a good grade for me to start touching on the kids. So I work with kids from the third grade to the sixth grade and teach them the history of aviation and how to operate radio control airplanes. That's the toy, the magnet that gets them in there. But they have to learn all the movements of that airplane. So by the time they're the 7th to the 9th grade, they're ready for ground school. And by the time they're in the 10th to the 12th grade, they're ready to graduate with a pilot license. And so it can be done, no matter where you come from, and it's all about the process of doing so. And so that's what I do for my retirement. I stay busier than I did with three jobs and one business and poor, but I love it, and as long as I like it and I keep on going with it and Edison doesn't cut my lights off and I'm not living in the street, obviously I'm doing the right thing. And I thank you.